Hello and welcome to yet another College Dunia session, Thoughtful Leaders. This is a platform where we invite top management from various colleges and universities and discuss their views on higher education. This is an initiative to bridge the gap between the vision of top management and the aspiring students. Today we have with us Dr. Vidya Yeravdekar. Dr. Vidya is the Principal Director of Symbiosis Society and the Pro-Chancellor of Symbiosis International University. Dr. Vidya holds a postgraduate degree in medicine, a degree in law, and a PhD in internationalization of higher education in India. She has been instrumental in bringing in innovative approaches to promote internationalization of higher education in India. Dr. Vidya has been a part of several government bodies such as University Grants Commission, Central Advisory Board of Education, Indian Council for Cultural Relations, among others. Dr. Vidya has presented papers at various national and international conferences and has numerous research publications to her credit. She has authored a book on internationalization of higher education in India based on her research and experience in this field. Welcome to the platform, ma'am.
Thank you.
To start this interaction, Dr. Vidya, we would like to understand the origin of Symbiosis International University and how has it evolved over the years.
Symbiosis was founded by my father, Dr. S.V. Muzumdar, way back in 1971. In fact, we are celebrating our Golden Jubilee year this year. We've just entered the Golden Jubilee. So when nobody even spoke about internationalization, foreign students, and so on, Dr. Muzumdar thought of this idea of doing something for foreign students who came to the city of Pune to study in various colleges and universities. He was a foreign students advisor appointed by the Pune University, and he was a professor of botany in one of the oldest colleges in Pune called the Ferguson College. And he realized that foreign students who came faced a lot of problems of language, of accommodation, homesickness, food, admissions, and so on. So he thought, why not start an organization to help these foreign students, because finally they will when they go out of India, they will be our unofficial ambassadors, and therefore we need to look after them while they are in India. And Symbiosis was actually started in our house with a few of his, I wouldn't say friends, but a few of his students who we taught in Ferguson College. So they came together and they started this organization. And the name Symbiosis was given because he was a professor of botany, and symbiosis is a botanical word which means living together of two different organisms for mutual benefit. So he believed that Indian and foreign students should live together and promote international understanding. And therefore, with the motto of Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, the world is one family, he established this small organization, which he never believed will grow into such a large multidisciplinary and multicultural university. So, a small organization then started off in 71, started with a few academic institutions of teaching English to foreign students. That was the first academic institution that he started in 1972 again. And then it was almost one institution every year, whether it was a law school or the business management, media and communication, computer science, and so on and so forth. And therefore, today we are a family of almost 70 institutions with over 40,000 students from all states of India and 85 different countries. So the Symbiosis family is very, very large. In 2002, the government of India conferred upon the deemed to be university status. And therefore, all the institutions that were initially affiliated to the University of Pune here came under the umbrella of the Symbiosis International University. And since then, of course, it's like getting wings to fly. You know, getting a university status is like getting wings to fly, because you can actually do a lot of innovations in academics. And that's what Symbiosis did. And today, if you see, Symbiosis is one of the largest universities. We have campuses in six cities, three in Maharashtra, that is Pune, Nagpur, and Nasik. One in Hyderabad, one in Noida, and one in Bangalore. So the spread is very large, the reach is very large, and fortunately our students are doing extremely well while they are at the university, and more importantly, when they pass out, their they assume almost top positions in the corporate world or whichever career that they choose to be in.
Thank you for the answer, ma'am. Continuing this discussion, like you mentioned, a strong, successful alumni base. What are the activities Symbiosis ensures to engage students with in order to make them industry ready?
So first of all, Symbiosis has a very strong industry academia interface, which means that people from the industry not only come and teach at various institutions, but they are also in decision-making bodies like the Board of Studies, the Academic Council, or even the Board of Management. Our alumni who are placed in the industry play a major role because they are present even during curriculum development, of course, for placements. And as I said, they actually come and teach and also are mentors to our students who are studying in Symbiosis. So there is an excellent industry-academia interface. And I think that's what brings Symbiosis closer to industry. Because we teach courses that are actually industry relevant, unlike some of the institutions where sometimes the courses become so obsolete that the students need to get retrained after they join the companies. But in Symbiosis, the feedback from the industry is excellent, and they feel that our students are industry ready and can be put into any job. This is one. Second is our students come from a very large talent pool that we select them from. So almost 1 lakh students appear for our MBA entrance exam, or more than 50,000 students appear for our undergraduate entrance exam. So, we get the best of best students. And not only that, the diversity in the classrooms, having students from different states, from different backgrounds, from different foreign countries, that also makes the classroom much richer when it comes to diversity of discussions. And I think that really makes Symbiosis students different, and that is what is really appreciated by the industry.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Continuing the discussion on the topic that you have done your doctorate in, and the Government of India has allowed foreign universities to be a part of India now. How do you foresee this bringing an impact on the overall education system?
So the new education policy is wonderful. I mean, it was just rolled out last month, and we as academicians were actually waiting for the new education policy to be rolled out. There are quite a lot of changes that have been made in the whole higher education system, as well as the school education system. But limiting my discussion to the question that you have asked about foreign universities coming and actually opening campuses, yes, the new education policy does talk about inviting top 100 world-class universities to come and open their campuses in India. I don't know whether that will really happen, because whether a Harvard or a Stanford or a Berkeley would like to have a campus in India, I'm not sure. But certainly they would like to collaborate with the best of the best universities in India. So I think the top ranking universities, as per the National Institutional Ranking Framework of Indian universities, should certainly gear up to collaborate with the top in the world. Because in India, the system is totally different, and I don't know whether a foreign university will really find this ecosystem conducive. Whereas probably they will find it more conducive to collaborate with one of the good universities in India, and it will be a win-win for everybody. I mean, for the Indian university as well as a foreign university. There will be, of course, a lot of competition, and I always believe that competition brings out the best, and therefore each university in India will try to do their best to, want to collaborate with a good foreign university. So I really see this as a great hope for Indian universities to even improve further than what they are right now. And it doesn't really matter whether these top 100 universities actually come and establish their campuses, or they come through a collaborative mode, as long as our Indian students get the best of education. And not only Indian students, but honestly, even the countries that are in our neighborhood would probably want to come and study in such collaborative ventures than really go to the US or UK, which is far more expensive for them. So students from the SAARC countries or from Southeast Asia or from Africa would want to come and study in India, because it is at a much affordable cost, and the living conditions are obviously much less expensive than what it is in Western countries.
Continuing this discussion further on NEP, you have been a part of several regulatory bodies in the past. How do you see the coordination changing when we talk about the implementation of the policy?
So, as I said, the NEP is really well drafted, and more importantly, it took almost about three to four years of hard discussions, not only within the task force or the committee members, but every stakeholder was consulted. So I would say that this is a policy that has been very, very, you know, consultative, and every stakeholder has had their opinions, which were taken, cognizance of. Some of us have also contributed by way of our, we being on several bodies like the FICCI Higher Education Committee, and we through FICCI have contributed to this new education policy as well. So it's a policy that actually belongs to each person, and it is a policy that is very progressive, because I think India is at a cusp where the world is looking at India, not just for education, but obviously for several other things, and people are curious about what's happening in India. And I would like to tell you that the new education policy that is so widely discussed amongst all of us as academia in our country, it is as widely discussed even in foreign countries, in universities abroad. The four-year program, which is more of a liberal arts program, was something that each one of us were really longing for. Of course, Symbiosis took a step of starting a four-year liberal arts program on way back in 2011. We've been the pioneers. We initially started with the Center for Liberal Arts in 2004 or 2005, and then in 2011 we actually set up a school of liberal arts with a four-year degree program in liberal arts. Now the new education policy discusses exactly the same, and it is very important, because you know what students need to get is not a really technical and tunnel view knowledge of things, but more of a liberal education, so that they become masters, you know, in whichever field or career that they choose to be, especially at the undergraduate level. And therefore, this whole multidisciplinary concept of the new education policy is something that, I think all Indian universities should follow at the undergraduate level, because it really makes no sense to create engineers without having a social sciences background. Otherwise, what is engineering for really if it doesn't really affect mankind? And therefore, so these kind of interdisciplinary interjections are very, very important. I mean, even doctors who do medicine should be taught a little bit of technology, a little bit of, humanities and so on, because finally you're dealing with human beings. You are going to use technology. So, you cannot really function in silos. And I think this is exactly what has been touched upon by the new education policy. Some other things of focus on teacher training is very, very important. They've also spoken about, having teacher education courses like professional courses, like you have medicine, law, engineering, pharmacology. So they feel that even teacher education should be a four-year undergraduate program, so that there is an emphasis on creating good teachers of, who have the sound knowledge of not just the pedagogy and the curriculum devising, but also have knowledge of all other subjects, and a focus on overall a multidisciplinary and liberal kind of education. They're also talking about a one-year master's, and I know they're aware that we lose a lot of our students to some of the foreign universities that have launched one-year master's programs. And if you do a four-year undergraduate program, then a one-year master program is good enough. They've given a focus on research. They've also segregated universities into teaching universities, research-intensive universities. So overall, the policy is pretty exciting. We are waiting for the implementation part, which is going to be arduous, because education is not just a central subject, but it is a state subject as well. And we have to see how the state governments really react and respond to the execution of this policy. But I think as individual universities, we can do wonders. We can just pick up a lot of things from this new education policy and actually implement them in our universities. And Symbiosis certainly wants to do that.
For the opinions, ma'am, final thoughts on NEP. As an academician, you have shared what all the fraternity was gunning for, and what the changes they suggested, and the final blueprint that has come. What do you think NEP 2020 will bring to the mindset of a common man, a parent, a recent graduate, or even a student who is pursuing his studies? What sort of mindset change are we talking about?
I think the mindset change of a student is going to be certainly I would say that, you know, this NEP and the new education system that has been brought in by the NEP is going to change the mindset of students. I would put it that way, because, you know, as I said, you know, liberal arts brings about liberal thinking. I mean, you need to have a much broader view of things if you want to find solutions to problems that are there in the society. Otherwise, where were engineers even exposed to the problems of society? They were only taught engineering in laboratories. Where did they even go out and look at really whether they can, you know, use this knowledge to the betterment of society? And I think this new education policy is exactly brought this in. You know, experiential learning. Why should engineers be taught or even doctors be taught only in laboratories? Why can't they go out on the field and see that whether they can really find an engineering solution to a problem in a village where there are no lights or where there is no water? Otherwise, what is the purpose of that education? So I think this whole change of mindset of students is going to be something that is really, you know, going to affect the society more in a positive way. This is one. Secondly, I think teachers' mindset needs to be changed, because teachers to teach that kind of education and training the teachers to teach that kind of education is going to be more critical, I personally feel. So therefore, I think a lot of emphasis on what really liberal arts education is, because we tell our students that, you know, you should think out of the box, critical thinking is important, or don't work in silos, work in teams. Do we ever tell our teachers this? Ideally, we should be telling our teachers, you know, how many of the teachers really work in teams? I mean, I would like to give the example of our university. Our marketing teachers would not see eye to eye. You know, someone who's teaching marketing in SIBM would not even know who's teaching marketing in SCMHRD. But whereas we broke these silos, we said, no, we brought in a concept of clusters. So we created clusters of teachers who were not just subject experts and, you know, had similarities in what they taught, but we brought in clusters of teachers where even teachers from engineering wanted to do, you know, or look at what consumer behavior is. So we got them in this cluster. We got, you know, medical professionals who were looking at, you know, behavioral studies. You know, they wanted to study behavior of maybe patients or patients' relatives. So we created these clusters where there was so much of interdisciplinary dialogues, and you won't imagine the kind of, you know, innovative work or research work that has come out of these clusters. And some of these clusters then migrated to become very research, you know, almost centers of excellence in some research disciplines, you know, like medical image analysis or nanoscience and nanotechnology. So we actually brought in engineering and medical teachers together, and it worked wonders. So I feel that these silos of teachers need to be broken. The teachers will also have to develop what we call as critical thinking or thinking out of the box, and that's when they will pass this on to the students. So certainly this new education policy is going to bring in a sea change in the whole higher education system in India.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Dr. Vidya, what impact do you think that the whole pandemic has brought onto the education system, and what are your thoughts on online education? Is it an interim solution, or is it a permanent one? Is it something that we will see becoming you know, part of the actual curriculum going forward, most of the classes being online and then moving from the offline shift?
So the pandemic just hit us in March, and you know, all of us were actually at the end of our semesters. We were, you know, almost nearing examinations and so on. So, you know, I must really appreciate our teachers, at least in Symbiosis, you know, who, you know, all of them really geared up to this pandemic and taught students online of whatever classes that were remaining, and of course took examinations online, did Vivas online. So, you know, it was a reaction to what was happening. While for the last several years, we were telling them to be, you know, building their capacity in online education. They did, some of them did, but it wasn't really as much as what we expected them to. But when this was, you know, when we were hit with this pandemic, they had no option. But they did it beautifully well, and it was an absolute seamless, you know, journey of students from where they were to passing out and, you know, moving on to the next semester that started in now July. So I would say it was more of a reaction to the pandemic. But now I think what we plan or what we are doing right now is more of a proactiveness on the part of teachers as well as the university, that over the lockdown period in April, May and June, we trained our teachers very well on what online education is all about. And we were one of the first universities to start our sessions in time in July, even for the new entrants, the postgraduate, of course, and undergraduates will now begin their online education. So we opened up our colleges for online education because students were just getting restless at home. I mean, they didn't know what to do. So you know, we had queries from students, parents, and we said, no, let's now we are ready. So we will open up to online courses. And I must again appreciate our teachers that, you know, from the 15th of July, they're engaging with students through the day very well with both synchronous as well as asynchronous learning, teaching. And let me tell you that online teaching is far more difficult than, you know, teaching a class full of students, because you see the students, you see their reactions, you know who understands or doesn't understand, whereas here you are on a blank screen where you just see names of students, and sometimes, of course, you know, they do come on screen and ask a question, but still you don't see the whole class in front of you. Like today I'm giving you giving an interview to you, and you know, I wish you were sitting in front of me and we could have probably spoken far more than what we are talking now. So it is different. Online education is you know, and it cannot be a solution to conventional education. I mean, I feel that, you know, now is the time more of blended education than online or conventional. So, you know, where the UGC had put in a cap of 20% can be done online or 20% cap for blended education. Now, I don't think it makes any sense for any regulatory body to keep a cap. It should be just left to the teachers and the university to decide, because there are certain courses that can be taught online even to almost 40%. And there could be certain courses that just cannot be taught online beyond 10%. I mean, what do you do with skill courses like a culinary arts or a photography or, you know, those kind of courses? How do you teach online? So I think they should leave it to the universities after this pandemic is over, and the universities would be the best people to decide how much should be taught online and how much should not be. But overall, I think this whole new normal, as we call it, is going to be normal of the day in the next few months, because we are at ease now. I mean, imagine the kind of Zoom meetings that we have on Google Meets or, you know, using other platforms. I mean, I wasn't so comfortable. I would always want a person in front of me. But now I know that, you know, the reach is far more. I mean, I've become more busier than what I was before. So, you know, the reach through online education is far more. So I believe that the world will be now be looking at a lot of online education, but universities, I personally feel, should go in for moving to blended education, because still in India, you know, the network, the bandwidth, you know, there are these challenges. How do you teach a student who's in a rural area? Much that he would be a bright student or they would be a bright teacher, but it's extremely difficult. So unless this whole you know, issue of reaching you know, to the last mile through you know, good internet access happens, although the government is trying to do their best and, you know, trying to bring in through television, through radio, you know, they're trying to do their level best to reach out to students, but still it will take some time. But I would say that the use of technology has been at its optimum now post-COVID, you know, and I think that's been a good sign. It was only students who were very, very savvy with technology and gadgets. But now I see teachers of our age being equally savvy. In fact, my father at the age of 85 is on Zoom meetings with us. I mean, he watches news, he reads now. He used to require a newspaper in his hand, but now he's happy using his mobile and reading news, you know, online. So I think that's brought in a great change for people of all ages, right from a 3-year-old to an 85. And I have, you know, both these ages in my house. I have a grandson who's 3 years old, who does his schooling online for about half an hour, 40 minutes every day. And I have my father who's 85, who's at ease with using technology.
That sums it up beautifully, what this pandemic has actually made us, you know, realize that learning can happen and at any age, and people can adapt to technology as long as they're exposed to it. Thank you for sharing your thoughts, ma'am. And before we conclude this session, would like to ask you to share with the students who are looking at Symbiosis International University as a future you know, stakeholder in their education. What is the message that you would like to share with them?
I think for students who are joining us, you know, this year specifically, I know there are a lot of, you know, I mean, they feel that there are a lot of challenges. It's not a very, you know, happy world, a happy environment. Some of them are depressed. Some of them don't know what's the future for them. But let me tell you that, you know, every cloud has a silver lining. And I think people who go through crisis, and this is my personal opinion professionally, whenever you go through a crisis, you always emerge out as a winner because you know, you are much stronger than, you know, people who never face crisis. So I think you're going to be strong individuals. You know, the university is going to take all its efforts to give you the best. In fact, you are very lucky that, you know, internationalization is in full swing because, you know, earlier we never had foreign teachers, as many foreign teachers teaching in the classes. But now through webinars, you know, the numbers have increased. So you will experience this whole internationalization during your time at Symbiosis. You will have several teachers from India, from outside of India, and eminent personalities who would otherwise, you know, not have time to come to the campus to address you. You have so many of them through the Symbiosis Golden Jubilee lecture series. You know, people like Javed Akhtar, and you have Saurav Ganguly, and you have, you know, people from different walks of life, Dr. Mashelkar, Kiran Mazumdar Shaw, and so many, Amitabh Kant, and several, you know, people. So you are going to get the best of education, I believe, you know, because you are the ones who are now be kind of even watched by the industry as to how well you are being prepared by universities. So I'm very sure that after you pass out, after 2 years of your postgraduate program or 3 to 4 years of your undergraduate program, you will certainly emerge as very, very successful individuals. So wish you all the very best and God bless you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for being a part of this this session. It was wonderful having you, and thank you for those insights that you shared with us.
Thank you.